Hello, and welcome back to California Geology. I am Dr. Robert Lopez, and today I'm going to talk about minerals. And you'll see that rocks are composed of minerals, and minerals are the building blocks of rocks, right? In order to identify and understand California rocks, we need to understand minerals, right? And in fact, I have the rock right here. This is actually a dioritic rock, granitic, it's a diorite. And you can see it's composed of many different minerals. One I can point out right here is a nice dark mineral called biotite mica. So this mica is common in Sierra granitic rocks. This lighter or this white color here is a feldspar, primarily a plagioclase feldspar. Then you can sort of make out a little bit of gray mineral there, and that's a quartz crystal, right? And then there's another dark mineral that kind of is a little bit longer than the biotite, and this is actually a hornblende crystal. In fact, you can see the hornblende is not quite as shiny or vitreous or as dark as a biotite. There's a biotite there, but right next to it, you can see the hornblende mineral there, right? So there's another good hornblende up over here. So this rock is composed of several minerals, an aggregate of minerals. And we'll first look at minerals in larger samples and do some background work on them. I always start off this lecture with minerals, defining what the definition of a mineral could be. So here I have the four-part definition of a mineral. The first is that a mineral is naturally occurring. It's an inorganic solid, has a specific chemical composition. A common mineral is SiO2. That mineral is quartz. And then the most important property, or the most important definition here, is that minerals have an internal crystalline arrangement of atoms. There's a specific order, repetitive order, how these minerals are going to be arranged within the crystal structure. And I got a little cartoon showing different atoms joined by these bonds, right? They're going to be bonded together. Here I have a model, actually, of the mineral halite, which is common table salt. Geologists call it halite. And it's composed of both sodium and chloride atoms, and they're all arranged in a specific order. Very specific order. Now, let's look down over here. Minerals are composed of atoms, right? Many of the same atoms constitute chemical elements. So in other words, if I have a whole bunch of atoms, I'm going to have a chemical element. Back here, I actually have silicon metal. This is the element silicon. If I could take one little tiny atom, which measures about an angstrom in diameter, which is about 10 to the negative 8 centimeters, enormously small, that one atom would still be silicon, right? It would have all the properties of this silicon metal. In fact, let's look at the atom and the chemical element. So if we look at the atom first, it's the smallest form of matter that retains the physical properties of a particular chemical element. In the case of my silicon over here, I have silicon, which is a chemical element, simplest form of matter that can be separated by chemical means. So in other words, we could do this in a lab. We do it here in the Santa Clara Valley. We separate a silicon from silica glass or quartz grains, quartz sand, and we separate the silicon in the laboratory and purify it. So this would be, if I could take the silicon metal, again, and this element and take one atom away, I'd still have silicon. It'd be very small, but it would still have those properties of the chemical element. Now, for the model of the atom, right, an atom will have a nucleus. And the nucleus is very small. Its diameter is about 1/100,000th of an atom. Very small. Remember, an atom is about 1 angstrom here. And in that nucleus, we have positive charges and these charges that are both negative and positive at the same time, which cancel each other out and become neutral, or those become neutrons, right? And both protons and neutrons exist in the nucleus. And it makes the nucleus very, very dense. In fact, that's where all the mass of the atom occurs. You'll figure out that the mass of the atom will be by counting the protons and the neutrons within the nucleus, right? In fact, we call that the mass number. So it's going to be the protons plus the neutrons in the nucleus. You count those up to give you the mass of the atom. Another important number is this atomic number. And this is just the protons in nucleus. You count those, only the protons. In this case, my protons here are in black, and I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I know that atomic number 6 is the element carbon. Atomic number 6 is the element carbon. And by convention, we always put the 6 as a subscript before the chemical symbol. Now, I know carbon has a variety of neutrons. It can have more than 6 neutrons in the nucleus. It could have 7 or 8, or as many as 8. And that means that there are going to be different types of isotopes. Remember, iso means the same. You can think of it as the same type. So carbon, let's put the 3 carbon isotopes that we know about. They're all going to have atomic number 6, right? Because that defines the atom. It tells 6 protons. Well, that's carbon. There's no mistake there. Carbon. However, there's carbon 12, there's carbon 13, and there's carbon 14. The difference between these other two is that carbon 13 and 14 have more neutrons than carbon 12. So I can figure out that carbon 13 will have 7 neutrons, whereas carbon 14 has 8 neutrons. But they all behave the same. They all behave exactly the same because they're carbon. So that's atomic number, mass number, and the isotope. In essence, the isotope is kind of similar to the mass number, because that would be this number here at the top. That superscript describes the mass number. And then, in terms of electrons, out here, not really orbiting, it's more like an energy environment, more like a shell. What you think is more of a round shell where these electrons exist. And they're going to be in different distances from the nucleus in these different energy shells. The first shell can only have 2 electrons. Subsequent shells can have up to 8. In this example, since I have 6 protons, I'm going to neutralize my carbon atom here with 6 electrons. So I make it electrostatically balanced. Now, some atoms tend to lose or gain electrons because they want to have in fact, we call it the octet rule. They want to have equilibrium with their outer electron shells full of electrons. Like this carbon atom, it's very reactive because it needs another 2, or actually another 4 electrons in this outer shell to make 8. Remember, the first shell has 2, subsequent shells can have up to 8. So it's going to bond with many different other atoms here on Earth. It's very reactive. Let's look at sodium and chloride, right? Well, in fact, before that, let's look. Yeah, well, we got sodium and chloride. And so remember, ions have a valence. They're going to have some charge because it's going to gain or lose an electron in order to fill that outer shell. And we can show that with sodium and chloride. Sodium is atomic number 11. So we'll put that down here, 11. Atomic number 11. Which means if I want to balance sodium with 11 electrons, I'll have to put those around the nucleus. So in the first shell, I put 2. So remember, the first shell only takes 2. In the second shell, I put 8 electrons. So that gives me 10. Now I have this one all by itself out here in the third energy shell. Sodium becomes very unstable. It's an explosive. If you get it in water, if you hold it and palms start sweating, it will burn your hand. So it's very nasty stuff. So what sodium does, it just gets rid of this electron. And now it's It's happy having 8 electrons, or it satisfies the octet rule by having 8 electrons around its outermost shell. Over here, chlorine is atomic number 17. And here I'll put 17 electrons around the nucleus of chlorine. 2 in the first, 8 in the second, that gives me 10. Then I have 7 sitting out here. You can think of sodium or of chlorine having a vacancy. And so what we'll do, sodium and chlorine will come together. The electron that's shed from the sodium atom will fill in into the chlorine outermost shell. Now chlorine has a shell full of electrons. Since sodium lost an electron, didn't lose any protons, it's going to be have a positive charge. And we call this a cation. Those ions that lose electrons are called cations. Now, chlorine gained an electron, so it's going to have a negative charge, and we often call these anions. So there's anions and cations. Now, this type of bond, where you're sharing, it's more of an electrostatic attraction between atoms, is called an ionic bond, right? An ionic bond. And it's a relatively weak bond. If you put sodium and chloride in water, it's going to dissolve over time. So many ionically bonded compounds are weak and dissolve in water. Now, a stronger bond is one called the covalent bond. This bond involves the sharing of electrons. So you share electrons in the outer energy shell. A good example is a water molecule. Here we have oxygen. With atomic number 8, so we put oxygen here as atomic number 8, so it's going to have 8 protons in its nucleus. I want to put 8 electrons around it. So there's 2 in the first shell, then I put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in the second shell. So oxygen would like to have 2 more electrons to fill this outer shell and have 8 in that shell. Hydrogen over here, well, that's atomic number 1, simplest, smallest atom. This one, well, only has 1 electron around it. So we put the 1 electron, so in this case, I highlighted in yellow. And so what happens is that the outer shell of hydrogen will overlap the outer shell of oxygen. And they will share electrons. Remember, the first shell only needs 2 electrons. So for this particular hydrogen atom, it's going to share its electron with oxygen, and oxygen will share its electron with hydrogen. So now there's 2 electrons around hydrogen. So it satisfies the outer shell rule there. Same thing with this one. Now, if we look at oxygen, right now it has 8 electrons around its outer shell. So it's happy, satisfying the octet rule. So that's an example of a covalent bond. And you'll see that the rock forming minerals, they're called the silicate minerals, have this covalent bond. Well, let's stop here for a minute, and then we'll continue on in just a minute.